It's like the brightest sunrise waiting on the other side of the darkest night. Don't ever lose hope, hold on and believe. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet. You're closer than you think you are. Only moments from the break of dawn. All these promises are just up ahead. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet.
Standing in your ruins feels a lot like the end. So used to losing, you're afraid to try again. Right now all you see are ashes where there was a flame. Truth is that you're not forgotten, this grace knows your name.
God's not done with you.
Your broken heart and your wounds and your scars.
God's not done with you.
Even when you're lost and it's hard and you're falling apart.
God's not done with you.
It's not over, it's only begun. So don't hide, don't run. 'Cause God's not done with you. There's a light you don't notice until you're standing in the dark. And there's a strength that's growing inside your shattered heart.
God's not done with you.
Even with your broken heart and your wounds and your scars.
God's not done with you.
Even when you're lost and it's hard and you're falling apart. It's not over, it's only begun. So don't hide.
gonna finish what he started. He's not done. God's not done writing your story. No, he's not done. God's not done with you. God's not done with you.
Good morning, City Church. I'd like to invite everybody to subscribe to our YouTube page and to like and share our Facebook page. Even start your own watch party. Is everybody ready to worship? Let me hear you say, yeah! I don't hear you. Yeah. Praise God.
Spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Graces waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark. Just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom. Bring on. Your burdens, bring all of your scars. Come back to communion, come back to the star. Run into wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Chains will fall.
mountains shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom, let there be freedom.
Peace like a river wash over me. Immerse me in water as deep as the sea. Hide me in love, your healing embrace. Peace like a river wash over me. As I worship your majesty, I worship your holy name. Jesus, my everything, all that I am is yours. Come, Holy Spirit, rain down on me. Break open the heavens, drench the unseen. Pour out your presence as I pour out your praise. Come, Holy Spirit, Lord, have your way. As I worship your majesty, I worship your holy name. Jesus, my everything, all that I am is yours. As I worship your majesty, I worship your holy name. Jesus, my everything, all that I am is yours. Open the heavens, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praise as we cry, holy, holy. Open the heavens. chains, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praises. We cry, holy, open, open the heavens, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, inhabit our praise as we cry, sing, whoa, 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 as we cry, holy, holy, yeah, oh, oh. Lord, send revival, Lord, send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Lord, send revival, Lord, send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Oh, Lord, send revival, Lord, send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Heaven break out. You've done it before, would you do it again? Oh, heaven break out, heaven break out, heaven break out, heaven break out. So Lord, send revival, Lord, send it now. A move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before. Let you do it again.
Yes.
Why?
on, everybody. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Ooh, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hallelujah. That's the highest praise that you can render unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ooh, for you are Lord God Almighty. Lord God Almighty. Almighty God, we need you, and we need you now. We need you in a mighty way, Lord. Oh, our country needs revival. Our states need revival. Our cities need revival. We need revival, Lord. Some of us need resuscitation. Move on us, Lord. Move in your mighty way, Father. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and fellowship. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and fellowship virus free. Lord, we thank you for your healing power. We thank you for keeping City Church free of the enemy. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for filling us with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, Father, that cleanses us, that purifies us, that keeps us unified, that revives us, that empowers us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, bless us all, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We've come to the part where we greet one another. And we can greet with a hug. We can greet with an elbow. We can greet with a wave. Just do it from the heart, from the Holy Ghost heart, from a Holy Spirit type of heart. Amen. Let's do that. Just say greetings. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you. All right. Amen. Thank you, guys. So like I told you last week that we are going to start charging a cover charge to come into the City Church Yoshi's nightclub. I don't know, but I think it's really cool. So this morning is kind of a little bit of a bittersweet. Jackie, come on down, Jackie. Come on. Yeah, come on. All right. Woo! Woo-hoo-hoo! Amen. Amen. Yeah, I have to do it. So we graduated, Jackie, some months back. And 1 year, amen, we graduated. It was awesome. And Jackie said, I'm not going to leave yet. Not everybody that we graduate leaves. We let folks stay as long as they feel that they need. But she wanted to complete a little schooling. And I think that's kind of done, right? Jackie handles all of our laundry. So as of next week, you might want to be careful who you sit next to, because they will have had no laundry service, and they could be a little stinky poo. So Jackie is leaving tomorrow at 4 a.m. Some folks are taking her to Sacramento. She's flying out to Kentucky. Now, that's the bitter. But the sweet is, it's to be with her son. Amen. 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 Jackie has prayed that God would reunite her with her son. How old is he?
He's going to be 11 on August 8th.
11. So she will be back to celebrate his birthday. And amen, amen. I'm not going to tell you the story. If you would like to know that story, you can meet up with her in the cafe. It is an absolute miracle what God has done in her life. Amen. So I'm going to ask you if you will stand with me. And Pastor LT, where are you at? There you go. All right. Grab that mic. And if you will just stretch out your hand, we want to send her with a blessing to Kentucky, that God will watch her coming, God will watch her going, God will open up the right doors for her, and her relationship with her son will grow stronger and stronger. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you for your grace. And we thank you for your mercy, Father. Father, we thank you for everything that you're doing, Father. We thank you for everything that you're going to do, Father. And Father, right now we just want to just humble ourselves in your presence, Father, and just give you glory for this young lady, Father. Give you glory, Father, for what you have done in her life, Father, and that you're going to continue to do in her life, Father. And Father, right now we know that you are doing something great and wonderful and marvelous, Father, in restoration, Father. And Father, we ask, Father, that your Holy Spirit, just continues to dwell in her and through her, Father, and draw others, Father. And when she go wherever she's going to see her son and be with her family, man, that your Holy Spirit just see you in her. See you, Father. And let them know that you are real and that you are a restorer, Father, and that you are a healer, Father. It don't make no difference what man says, Father. We know what you said, Father. You said that you are with us, that you are with her, that you would never leave her, Father, nor forsake her, Father. And Father, right now, she's proving it. She's proving it, Father, with integrity and accountability, Father, that she's real and sincere about this walk with you, Father. And Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Father, we're asking for traveling mercies, Father, as she get on this plane, Father. And I'm asking, Father, that you touch the pilot's hands, Father, and that let their flight be smooth, and let anything that's going to be jittery in her subside. It's a good jittery, Father, because she's going to her son, Father. And right now, Father, we give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I have a couple of things that I just want to share really, really quick. We want to give a shout out to Harvey. Harvey is in our sound booth today. We have had a number of upsets. We are dealing with some very old, outdated equipment. In fact, the popping that you heard is actually coming from this mic, and they told me you better buy a new mic this week, so I get to spend more money. But we came to a place where we just said we need to make some upgrades. We need to make upgrades for our live stream. So those of you that are watching live, we want to thank you for tuning in. And work with us just for a week or two as we're introducing some new equipment and we're trying to iron out the bugs. We believe that by making these changes that we'll be state-of-the-art and as good as anything you see out on TV. So we're working hard at that, and it has been a job. So thank you for being patient. And I want to introduce, how many of you know that we talk a lot about our City Free Clinic? Yes. Yeah, it's up and running. Yes. All right. There have been some of you that have already benefited from the City Clinic, and I think we have five folks scheduled to go over at 3. And but I want to tell you where it all started. It all started with this man right here, Dr. Michael Klein. Stand up. Just stand up. Very modest. But we want to thank you for all that you do, that you are doing for the kingdom of God. I love it when God partners us with the right people. Because then they bring a gift to the table that God uses for his glory and the benefit of the kingdom. And that's what we're all about. We're not here to be a something or a that. We're here to bring the kingdom of heaven on earth. That's what Jesus said. May your will be done as it is in heaven. Let it be done on earth. And that's our goal. That's our vision. That's what we work for. Amen. So thank you for joining us today. And Pastor Pam is coming to take our deposit.
The Lord did give me a scripture this morning concerning our giving, our deposit, so we call it here at City Church. He gave me Proverbs 3, I think it's 9 and 10. Let me find it real quickly. It says, glorify God with all your wealth, honoring him with your very best. With every increase that comes to you, then every dimension of your life will overflow with blessings from an uncontainable source of inner joy. I know he gave me the thing about joy and faith a couple of times here recently. I just feel like he's saying, look at what you have differently. For me, I haven't experienced a lot of money wealth in my life, but I've been sowing so that God would give me the power to get that kind of wealth because I want to be that kind of a blessing to the kingdom too. God says it's more blessed to give than receive. If I'm not blessed, even with money, I can't give money to the kingdom cause. And it does take money. God can do everything supernaturally if he so chooses. I don't want to restrict him. But for some reason in this world, we still need money to operate and to bring kingdom blessings to our communities. The Lord told me that he is our example of blessing. In the Jewish prayers, they start out their prayers with, I'm going to say Hebrew a little bit here, Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. They start out their prayers like that. It means, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe. He's our example of blessing. And if we're made in His image, we're brought here to bless in whatever way that we can. It doesn't matter what amount of money you have. It matters if you have a penny this morning. Put it in the offering and expect from God to increase it. Just like those fishes and loaves increase. Increase it for City Church and the community things we're called to do here. And believe that God wants to increase you too. So bring it joyfully. Whatever you have to bring, even if it's just you. Say, God, all I got this morning is you, but I give you my best. I give you my best with this penny. I give you my best with this dollar. Whatever it is, it doesn't matter. He's looking at our heart motive and intent and our faith. So let's pray. Lord, Father God, we thank you for increase. We thank you for helping us to see differently that no matter what we have to bring, it's wealth, and we bring it joyfully with an expectation in you to increase it so we can do greater kingdom business on this earth. We thank you for increasing our lives too in the process. We want to be blessed beyond measure too, because it's more blessed to give than receive. So we give you all of the glory in advance as you increase our wealth on this planet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Awesome. Well, we're going to jump right in this morning. We're actually jumping into a new topic, a topic that God kind of just laid on my heart. I have pretty much, for the most part, I can't say I've grown up in church, but I've spent all of my adult life in church. And I've been mainly to hardline Pentecostal churches. I'd like to say that I've seen it all. And I personally, they say that a pastor should teach on giving at least twice a year. And if you've been coming to City Church for any length of time, you will know that we really do not do that. I don't know what it is that makes me feel a little uncomfortable. We don't call our giving at church an offering. And we do that on purpose because we don't want to imply that you are making an offering to God because, I don't know, just somewhere in me, it says that God needs your money, that God is begging you to give. And I know that a lot of pastors, that's how they approach it. You gotta give, man. You gotta give. We gotta pay the bills. And I've been in churches where they've taken the offering and they've gone back and counted it. And if it wasn't enough, they came out and took it again. In fact, I was in one church where they took it three times. And anyway, we call it a deposit, because it is an opportunity that God gives you to sow into the kingdom of heaven's banking system. That's the way I like to put it. And if you probably have heard me say a number of times, but our banking system right now, if you look at your statement and you look at the rate of return, it isn't even worth looking at. And God said that when you invest into the kingdom of heaven's banking system, his rate of return is unbelievable, because it is pressed down and it is shaken together, getting all the air out. If you've ever worked with flour and you want to get more in the jar, you shake it and bounce it and you sift it so it goes down and you can put more in. He said, that's the way I give back to you. That's how I will give back to you. So when we give, it is an opportunity for us. God doesn't need your money. In fact, we're going to see in a little bit, he tells you that what you have in your pocket, he's given to you in the first place. So don't kid yourself. Don't think you're doing God a big favor by throwing a buck and hollering, because God don't need it. But he gives you the opportunity because he so wants to bless you and he wants to bless me. So we're going to jump in. I'm going to spend a number of weeks talking about this as we work our way through it. And we've titled this simply Rewards. We're going to look at a number of aspects about rewards, because giving has rewards attached to it. If God had no rewards attached to it, I would give to him with all of my heart simply for what he's done in my life. And if that's not enough, he said, I'm going to do you one better. Not only am I going to give you a life worth living, and I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to prosper you, and I'm going to do good things, but then when you give back, I'm going to do even more just to blow your mind. So, Richard Halvorson said this. He said, Jesus Christ said more about money than about any other single thing, because when it comes to a man's real nature, money is of first importance. Money is an exact index to a man's true character. All through Scripture, there is an intimate correlation between the development of a man's character and how he handles money. I thought that was very interesting, and it is very, very true. Now, let me just take a minute, and I'm going to give you two stories. Pretend that you are a counselor, and you have an appointment with a lady, your first appointment. A lady comes in to see you, and she says, you know, my husband died 3 years ago, and he left me barely enough money to live on. And I really want to give to missions. I really want to give to missions. But if I give to missions, I probably will not have enough to pay my bills. what should I do? Now ask yourself, what advice would you give her? What advice? You don't have to shout it out, but just think for a minute. She's come to you and she says, I only have so much money. My husband's died and I'm living on this small amount of monthly income, but if I give anything to missions, I won't have enough to pay my bills. What advice would you give her? Well, some would say, God knows your needs, honey, and God knows what you have to live on. So don't give anything to missions. You need what you have to live on, because after all, God doesn't just rain groceries out of heaven. So go and be blessed, and God bless you, and we'll pray for you. Okay, an hour or two later, you have your second appointment, and this is a nice younger couple, maybe in their 40s, and they come in and they say, Pastor, we have this problem. We got a dilemma. We're arguing about this, and we want you to settle this for us. We make a decent income, but we're saving money to build our dream home. We want to build our dream home because when we retire, it's our goal to live on this 10-acre parcel that we've already bought, and we've closed the escrow, and we're saving now to build our dream home. And if we give any money to missions, we may not be able to build our dream home, and we'll have to stay right where we're at. What do you think we should do? Well, a lot of folk would say, well, you know, you worked hard and you worked hard and you deserve what you have. And by all means, just keep saving to build your dream home. You guys work so hard, you just kind of deserve it. God bless you. Go in peace. That sounds very reasonable, right? It sounds like the common thing to say, the caring, the loving response. But what if I were to tell you that both of these stories are in the Gospels and Jesus talked about both of them? What if I were to tell you that? What if I were to tell you that he approached it a little bit different? In fact, I'll prove it to you. Let's go to Matthew chapter 12, and we're looking at verse 41 through verse 40. In Matthew chapter, Mark, I'm off. And I even have cheater note tabs here to get me there, and I'm still off. Mark chapter 12, verse 41 through verse 40. It says, then he sat down near the offering box. This is Jesus. He sits down near the offering box. You know, I am so messed up today. I even brought the wrong Bible. I brought the Passion, and I told the booth to put up NIV. So I'm just going to read it from there because I'm really... Woo! Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put, and he watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury, and many rich people threw in large amounts. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. Interesting, isn't it? We're going to come back to that in a minute, but let's jump to Luke chapter 12, verse 15 through verse 21. This is another story. And then he said, this is Jesus, he said, watch out and be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. We live in a society today that the more you have, the more you're to be respected, and the better people think you are. In fact, I've seen bumper stickers that say, "He who dies with the most toys wins." I can tell you, I've done enough funerals to know that that is a lie from the pit of hell. Because if I do your funeral, whether it's an open casket or a closed casket, and I look inside, you ain't got no toys in there. You're going out the way you came in. You're taking nothing with you. So he who dies with the most toys still dies. So he says, and he told them this parable, the ground of a certain rich man yielded abundant harvest. Notice, let me just point out, I could go off on this portion of scripture for days, but I'm just going to point out just a few little innuendos that the writer is saying. Remember, when the writer gives you a specific, he's giving you a specific to make a point so you don't miss it. He says the ground of a certain rich man, it yielded an abundant harvest. In the Passion Bible, it says a bumper crop. Now the note here is that he had nothing to do with it. The ground gave it to him. God gave it to him. He had nothing to do with it. And in fact, we find out he's surprised by it because he knows he had nothing to do with it. And he thought to himself, wow, oh man, what should I do? I have no place to store all of this. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I know what I'll do. I figured it out. I'm going to tear down my barns and I will build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. Let's stop right there. Is there anything wrong with what he just said? It's his bumper crop. Most would say he's being an astute businessman. I've got a bumper crop. My barns can't hold it all. So I'll tear my barns down and I'll just build bigger ones so that I can store all of it in there. And then maybe I can retire and have an easy life, right? Some would say, good job, man. Good job. But remember, the ground gave it to him. God gave it to him. But God said, you fool, this very night, your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich towards God. Now, what Jesus is sharing in this story isn't that it's wrong to make investments for a later time in life. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, basically, that though the widow was poor on earth, she was rich in eternity. She had priorities right. Though I'm poor on earth, I'm rich through eternity. Your 70, 80 years here on earth is nothing compared to eternity, which has no end. I would rather be rich there and a little bit do without here so that I'm well-to-do there. And then to the rich guy who was well-to-do here, he was eternity ignorant. And Jesus said to him, if you're going to be eternally foolish, she was eternally wise. But to him, if you're going to be eternally foolish, you need to be very careful because your life may be called today. I shared this story a few times, and I know better than to share it again. But I'm just going to share a little snippet of it. I had business dealings years, many years ago with a very, very wealthy man. Very wealthy. And he owned a couple of exotic car dealerships. And in my dealings with him, he let it be known to me how rich he was and how I wasn't up to his status. He made that very clear. He made it clear as I was standing on his dock and he was powering in remote control his new boat, which, if I remember right, was a Sea Ray Sundancer at about 45 feet. And he remote controlled it, and he let me look at it, but I couldn't get on it because that offer was never made. And we went into his very expensive home, which was one of many homes, which he made sure I knew that this was his Saturday home, and on Monday he would go to his Monday home. And I walked out of there feeling less than. In fact, I told my partner, who was also a fairly wealthy man, I told my partner, I said, you know, I'm not going to do business with this guy. I cancel the deal. I'm out of it. I'm not doing business with this guy because I don't like his attitude. I don't like his ego. And really, really what the truth be told was I don't like the way he insulted me. That's really, if the truth were told. So anyway, I went on and got over it. And some months later, my partner called me up. He said, do you know what happened to so-and-so? I said, no, what happened to so-and-so? He said, well, he was on a very expensive vacation. And they had just finished this very expensive vacation. I don't know, Italy or something. And they were flying back. And on his way back, he had a heart attack on the plane and he died. You know what the first thought I had? The very first, I had two, almost side by side. The very first thought was, who gets the boat? And what happens to the Ferrari dealership? That's the first thought I had. And I thought, I hope his kids are pretty smart or they'll ruin everything he spent a lifetime building. And you know, he wasn't that old. The Passion Bible, when it talks about this wealthy man, it uses the words something like this: the messengers have come to ask for your life, you fool. They've come to ask for your life. And you know, when I read that, now I can't say that this is good theology, so if you're smart and don't think I'm trying to promote something that's not biblical, but let me just tell you my intuition into the text. Because in the NIV, Jesus says, this is the way it will be with those who don't build wealth in heaven. Did you catch that at the end of that verse? Put that up. Whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich towards God, this is how it will be. So I read into that text just something to say that heaven is watching. And those that are not storing up wealth in heaven, but are storing up wealth here, messengers start saying, call for their life. Call for their life. Let's end their life. Because they're poverty stricken in heaven. Now, I can't prove that. Don't tell anybody I said it. That's just, I'm reading in maybe a little bit more than I should, but I'm reading in a little bit. This tells me that our beliefs about money are completely different than God's. God has a different thought process when it comes to money. You see, even today, I thought about this. I thought about folks that make it onto Charisma magazine cover. I thought about people that make it onto TBN, the Christian Network, and all of those medias and publications, and I started to think it's all people with possessions, money and wealth. I did some research once about some of the very guys that I respect and found out what they were worth, and it boggled my mind. And I don't care how they justify it, that's between them and God. me, it's not okay. Or how big the whatever they do, how big it is, and they make it on the cover of Charisma magazine. Look how grandiose so-and-so is. Look at the size of the building that they meet in. And I started to think, when was the last time you saw a poor missionary who had given his life on a foreign mission field in poverty, who goes unnoticed? When have they ever been on Charisma or TBN or any other publication? When is somebody celebrated for what they do in the kingdom rather than what they have in the kingdom? I heard a story about a missionary that was coming back from the mission field, and he asked his wife, he said, I wonder how many people will be there to greet us. I wonder how many people know that we've lived our whole life here on the mission field giving to people. How many will be here to greet us? And as the boat pulled into the port, there were thousands of people cheering and waving and had signs. And he said to his wife, he said, this is amazing. Oh, they knew that we were coming back. And he was so happy till he read the sign. And he realized that there was a famous actor on the boat with them. And those people were waiting for the actor. And when the actor came down and everybody came around and people took pictures and they escorted him away, then all of a sudden when it is his time to come off the boat, there was nobody there. And he said to his wife, nobody is here to welcome us. Nobody cares what we gave. Nobody noticed. And she said to him, honey, we're not home yet. We're not home yet. Jesus doesn't tell us to sell everything. He did to a guy, a rich guy. He did to him because this guy had some problems with money and he threw out a condition. If you're going to follow me, sell what you have to follow me. What Jesus is saying is this. I can't be Lord. Now, remember, we did a series on is it Savior, Lord, or Lord, right? He cannot be Lord as in I'm your Lord and Master. Not Lord in name only, not title, not a title. A lot of people say, oh, you're Lord Jesus Christ. Title, but you're not really my Lord. You're just Lord Jesus Christ. But I can't be your Lord if you have other gods, small g, in your life. I can't be that in you if you have other gods, small g, in your life because you'll love one and hate the other. I can't do that. He cannot be the Lord in our life if he's not the Lord over the God money, small g, the God money. He has to be Lord over that also. Now, it doesn't mean that you're going to sell your car and sell all your clothes and sell. I'm not saying that. And I would never recommend that. I would if he asked you to do it. That's the difference. If he is Lord, and he is Lord over my pocketbook, does that mean he controls my pocketbook? Only you can answer that. Is he Lord over our pocketbooks? Let me give you a couple statistics. If you have enough food to eat, and you live in an apartment or a home, you have shelter, and you have some type of transportation, could be a bicycle, could be a skateboard, it could be a car, you are in the top 15% of the world's wealthy. Did you know that? That tells me that almost every person in this place is in the top 15%. you are so wealthy compared to the world that we just don't know it. Let me carry it a little further. If you add a little savings, you've got $100 in the bank, and you have possibly a second car, it could be a hoopty, and you have more than one or two changes of clothes. I see you every Sunday. I know you do, because you always wear something different. And you have a home to stay in. You are in the top of the world's 5%. You can go to almost anywhere else in the world, and you could see extreme poverty, where there isn't enough to eat, there isn't places to sleep, and there is no transportation but where your feet can get you to. Do a little bit of math. If a man or a woman works from 25 years of age to 65 years of age, and he earns only $25,000 a year without pay raises, without Social Security, nothing added to it, by the time he's 65, he will have made $1 million. He will have made $1 million. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 17 through 18 says this. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands has produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms His covenant, which He swore to your forefathers. He gives you the ability, He gives me the ability to obtain, to earn wealth. Let's go back to the widow for a minute. Let's go back to a widow. Something in the text that you may have skipped over, but notice that when Jesus was watching them give money, He was close enough. He was close enough to see this old lady with old wrinkled hands holding two coins and drop them in the box. How close do you think that has to be? It had to be closer than those sitting in the front row to me, because I couldn't make out exactly what was in your hand unless you showed it to me. But if you went up to the box and you dropped it in, I could hear it, but I couldn't see it. Not only that, he saw that they were copper coins. I have one on my desk that was given to me by a coin dealer that was from this time period. Very, very small. In fact, it's so small that it would get lost in your pocket. He was close enough to see it. He was standing close enough watching what people were putting in. And when he saw her with her little shriveled up hand holding two coins, not one, but he counted two. And he said, they're copper. So he knew the value of them. He was close enough to watch. Well, someone said, well, and you know what? He was watching, and he never apologized. That just jumped out at me in the text. Dude, you're not being very discreet. You walk right up and you're watching everybody. Put them up. Oh, look at that. And he makes no apology. Well, see, some people say, it's my money, and what I do with it's my business. Can I tell you? No, it's not. It's his business too. Because he's close enough to watch what you do with what you have. Don't ever think God pays it no mind. Don't ever think God don't care. I ordered something. Somebody shared a website with me that it's an expensive product line, and they had access to 70% discounts, 75% discounts, and I went, woo. And so I was flipping through the thing, and I came across this thing I've been looking for a long time, a couple of years now, and nothing rocked my world, or it was too expensive or whatever. And I come across it, I said, "Ooh, I'd really like to get that," and it wasn't that much money, and I said, "Ooh, this would be really cool." And because I'm doing this study, I said, "Do I absolutely have to have it?" No, kind of do. The other one I have is kind of old and getting scuffed up and rickety rackety, but I don't have to have it. I'd like to have it. And you know, I looked at that thing every day for a week. I even went to Deborah and I said, would you mind if I bought this? And she said, "Oh, for heaven's sakes, go buy it. It's not that much money. What are you stressing over?" Well, I was stressing. Because I'm thinking, God, what you have given me, you've given me for a purpose. So I had to say to the Lord, I had to say, "Is it okay if I go buy that for me? I don't have to have it. I kind of like it, but I don't have to have it. Is it okay? Because if I don't feel right in my heart, I'll take that money and I'll put it some other place." And I waited, and I waited. And I waited, and then I stopped looking at it because it was just killing me. And then one day I felt God said, "You go ahead and get it, but that's about it for now." So I did. It's ordered. All I'm saying is He's watching. And we need to take that into consideration. Okay, number two, we're going to pick up real quick. Who robs who? Who robs who? Do you get robbed? Does God get robbed, or does the other person get robbed when you don't financially help somebody? Who gets robbed? It's God's desire to bless you and I. That goes back to the Abrahamic covenant. In fact, it was embedded in one of the verses we read earlier. "According to my covenant with Abraham, I have blessed his seed." You and I have become children of Abraham through Jesus Christ, and as heirs with Abraham through Jesus Christ, we're an heir to all of those promises. God cannot take them back. They're ours. I have a promise in God to prosper that cannot be taken back. And God gives me the method, the means, the way to inherit, to get that promise and make it mine. He's given me the avenue to do it. Now, what if I said to you, "I've got a great gift for you in the trunk of my car. You're just going to love it. I knew you wanted it for a long time. And I went out and bought it. And it cost me a lot of money. And it's in the trunk of my car. And Sister Tanya, it's yours. I'm going to leave my car keys right here. And after church, you come get them. Go in the trunk and take it." And I walk away. But you sit on that front row and you never come up and get the car keys, will you ever get what's in the trunk? I gave it to you. I told you I gave it to you. And I gave you the means to get it. But if you don't exercise the means to get it, you'll never get it. Interesting, huh? So the question is if God has given me the means to be blessed, the question I have to ask myself, how much have I missed out on in life because I've not done what he said in order to be? How much have I robbed me? How better off would I be now if I had blessed others more? Well, let's carry it a step further. How much more would you have in heaven? Because there is a coming a day. There is coming a day where you will see. How much greater wealth would I have built in heaven? Interesting, huh? So see, who do I rob? I don't rob the other person. I don't rob God. It's impossible to rob God. Though Malachi said, will a man rob God? Are you stupid enough to rob God? But I rob me. I rob me now with what God would do in my life now, and I rob me in eternity what God would give me through eternity. So I rob me both ways. Blessing now and blessing through eternity. Pastor Pam said it great. It's not the amount that you give. It's the heart in which you give it. Remember the widow? Jesus said of those dumping in large sums of money, he said these guys dump in large sums of money, but this widow, this poor widow, I've watched her put in two small copper coins. She's given more than them all because she's given from her substance. Jesus didn't chide her, didn't ask her why. In fact, Jesus, in essence, commended her to the disciples. And we have it now in the Gospels, and people preach messages all over about it. This woman is famous because of what she did. Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to end with this. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 through 24 says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Still talking about money. The subject has not changed. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body then is full of darkness. If then the light within you is dark, how great is that darkness? He's talking about how you look at money. Prove it. He's back, circle back around in the text. He's come full circle. He's back around. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and you will despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Some translations use the word God. You cannot serve God, big G, and God, small g, money, the God of money. There, I believe there is a demonic God over money. I believe that. Doesn't mean that money is bad, but I believe that that demonic God influences people to strive after it, to fight over it, to be proudful because they have it, and all of the evil that it can produce. Money in itself is not evil and can produce a lot of good things. But it can also do a lot of bad stuff and can corrupt a person. And as in the rich young ruler, send them to hell. A.W. Tozer said this. Now remember, Jesus is all about storing up money. But there's only two places you can do it. You get to choose. A.W. Tozer said, we can answer this question by asking four simple questions about heaven or earth investing. Number one, what do you value most? Where is your heart? What do you value most? What do you most hate to lose? What do you most hate to lose? What do our thoughts turn to most frequently? And what affords us the greatest pleasure? Let's bring that down a notch in relationship to money. If you value it, you place it in a safe place, right? I have in my office a big floor safe. It's huge. And you're not going to get it out of my office, trust me, unless you come with some help. And when somebody gives me a chunk of change, I go right to that safe and I put it in that floor safe. Big safe, it's not in the floor, but, and I lock it up and I can leave because I know nobody's going to get it. I don't leave it on my desk and I don't carry it around with me. It goes right in that gigantic safe. And when I throw that handle and I turn it out, I walk away going, ah, 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 nobody's going to get it. Because I value that money and I put it in a safe place because I would hate to lose it. And what do you think of most frequently? You know, I've been doing a lot of studying about heaven, and the more I study about heaven, and I find that is written on heaven and it is embedded within the Bible, the more interested I am in heaven. And my whole life's focus has changed to existence in heaven, because this is really nothing. The Bible said this is like a vapor. It comes and goes. It's like a blade of grass. It sprouts up one day and is gone the next. Don't put everything you have into what you do here. Make wise investments into heaven, because that's where you will get the greatest pleasure. See, instead of viewing money simply as an end and a do-all and a thing, it's a means to a greater end. And it's all in how you use it. And Jesus, he offers us the opportunity to store it in the best place. A place where you get a reward now, you get pressed down, shaken together, running over, and then you get a reward later. And it will blow your mind. Two scriptures, Chronicles 29 and 14 said, "But who am I? Who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand." 2 Corinthians 9 and 11 says, Paul says, "You will be made rich in every way." In every way. So that you can be generous on every occasion. You will be made rich in every way. So that you can be generous on every occasion. When you and I are given increase, sometimes it's simply because God loves us and he wants to bless us. The Bible says that he gives us all things to enjoy. Sometimes it's not for you. You're simply a conduit to get it to the right person. And that's where you have to be very sensitive to the Lord. This big raise I got, is it for me? Is it for me, God? I can go buy a lot of stuff. I remember as a young man, I worked a menial warehouse job, and somehow they got me mixed up with somebody else, and then I was brought in to be this executive of a Citizen Watch Company. I was over the import-export division and over all of the shipments in the United States. it's a story how that happened, and this isn't the place, but it's a miracle that God took this forklift driver one day and made him this guy the next day. Anyway, I made my my paycheck went through the roof. One day I'm driving forklifts, the next day I'm making a small little fortune for my life at that time. And I'm thinking, what can I buy? What can I buy? I always wanted a Porsche. I'm going to go buy a new Porsche. And I'm just going crazy. And I'm sitting on the front row of church. And God said to me, God said, son, I'm blessing you, but that ain't all yours. I gave it to you. You didn't earn it. Who do you think got you mixed up with being a different guy? I gave it to you. You don't get to keep it. It's mine. And I said, what do you mean, God? What do you mean? Now, at that point, I was tithing and giving and doing everything right. God said, you know that 10% you give? Let's double it. Let's make it 20. And then I want you to give offerings. Okay. Then he said, let's start today. You take your wallet and empty everything out of your wallet into the offering. We'll start right now. And do you know I did that? It wasn't easy. I won't say it was easy. But remember, if he ain't God over your money, he's not God in your life. Lord of everything or Lord of nothing. He doesn't play around. It ain't a little here and a little there. It's everything or nothing. But I could spend another hour or two telling you how God blessed my life from that moment on. Unbelievably blessed. Open opportunity after opportunity, blessing after blessing that I didn't deserve, I didn't earn, I didn't even have the mental capacity to do it, but God would drop these things right in my life. You'll never go wrong when you invest in the kingdom because he invests right back. I don't know what I have in heaven. I'm going to find out one day, but at this point in my life, I'm trying to increase that account. I'm trying to really increase that account. Deborah and I are trying to make big, we're sowing into that because someday we're going to stand before the Lord and we want him to say, well done. Now come and look what I have for you. That's a choice that we all get to make. Jesus said, you know, I was thinking, if a little kid has some gum in their pocket and I wheeled in a brand new bicycle and I said, would you give me a stick of gum? I'll give you the brand new bike. Do you think they would do it? Wise investment. Take what God has given you. Invest wisely. Amen? Let's stand together. We're going to close. Amen. While we're closing, I'm going to ask you to do something a little bit different. We've never done this. Just turn around in your seat and look at that camera in the back. Can we do that? Camera in the back corner there. Wave, Paul. That's our camera guy. And those are all the people watching us online. They're not here. They're at home. Some are sick. Some couldn't make it. But we're going to pray that God blesses all of them. Amen? We've been blessed here. We're going to pray that God blesses them right there at home. All right? Can we do that? All right. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the fact that you invite us to invest. You invite us to partake in heaven's blessings. And we thank you for the opportunity that we have to do that. Father, I pray for everybody that is watching online this morning. I pray that you just bless them, that you rock their world, that you bless their home, that you bless their lives. And Father, if there's anybody at home that's sick today, I pray that you reach down, you touch them, and you heal them. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Wave at them. Amen. All right. We have a great lunch in the cafe for you. If you can hang, if you'd like to, stay in fellowship. You could run away, leaving me there in my shame, leaving me fighting my pain.